Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Hiding in Plain Sight, How a Jewish Girl Survived Europe's Heart of Darkness, by Pieter van Os. Translated by David Doherty. Narrated by Suzanne Toren. Prologue. The Bug. Collect everything and sort it out after the war. Emanuel Ringelblum, historian. When she went out to feed the pigs once a day, the farmer's wife tossed the family's leftovers beside the trough. Through a small opening in the floor, the food reached five hungry people hiding below. Her husband had reckoned no one would go looking for Jews under a pigsty. He was right. Three of the five survived the war, though when liberation came, they bore little resemblance to the people who had knocked on the farmer's door 3 years earlier. A human being can barely exist on one meager ration of leftovers a day. Crouching for days on end takes a dreadful toll on the body. The two who did not live to see liberation had briefly left their hiding place in the hamlet of Godlevo-Vielkie to recover belongings they had hidden near their home. They probably hoped these goods would help them obtain more food from the farmer or offer greater protection from the rats, the frost, the rainwater, or the stink and the filth of the pigs. They did not survive their expedition. The farmhouse is still standing, though today it serves as another farmer's shed, and decades of sun and rain have turned the wood a mousy gray. The new farmhouse is 15 meters away, the plaster on its outer walls crumbling to expose the shoddy workmanship of large building blocks poorly laid. The shed stands for a distant past. The farmhouse for a future that has already slipped away. Square and flat-roofed, the house looks like a miniature block of flats, with two floors and two identical balconies just big enough to hold a couple of bin bags. A satellite dish completes the picture. The Poles refer to these small farmhouses as kostka prolowskas, or little commie blocks. Mini versions of the blocks of flats that sprang up in the big cities of the Polish People's Republic. Everyone calls them bloki. For 4 years, I lived in a city full of bloki, Warsaw, the capital of Poland. From there, I often traveled east, searching for people and places connected to a personal history that had captured my imagination. Most of these trips took me along the river Bug, spelled B-U-G, and as we drove, I would try to erase the square buildings from the landscape. One of the few certainties from the story I was chasing was its place in history. Before 1946, a time when farmhouses did not resemble little blocks of flats. And so, in a farmer's back garden some 100 kilometers from Warsaw, I concentrate on the wooden shed and picture it as it once was, a farmhouse at the time of the Second World War. With that image in mind, I go looking for the pigsty that must have stood beside or behind it. The Jews dug the pit beneath the pigsty, together with the farmer and his young son, in the summer of 1941, soon after German forces seized control of this part of Poland. The Jews, the farmer, and his son dug to a depth of almost 6 feet. It took them 2 days. I cannot find the place where the pigsty stood, and the Blocky Farm's present owner is not inclined to help. To him, my story sounds odd at best, and he drones on about never having met the owner from the 1940s. I'm new around here, he says, which means he arrived in the 50s. A Polish friend has come with me to interpret. As we drive back to Warsaw, she asks me what the Polish Jews hiding at the farm have to do with the book I'm writing. I come up with a halting answer or two. One is that they came from Chijevo, 4 miles to the north. Now known as Chijevo Sada, the town used to be a shtetl, where my protagonist's mother and her parents once lived. Besides, I add, this is a story of Polish Jews who tried to survive the war in the Polish countryside, something my protagonist also tried to do for several months. My Polish friend smiles. "Go down that road," she says, "and you can travel forever." She does the maths. In Chijevo, 85% of the population was Jewish, which adds up to a few thousand individuals. Are all their attempts to survive relevant to my book? Her calculations don't stop there. In 1939, Poland was home to approximately 3.5 million Jewish citizens, at least 250,000 of whom sought refuge in the countryside. Do you need to know all their stories, too, to gauge the value of your protagonist's story? The protagonist she is referring to is a woman who lives in the Dutch town of Amstelveen, effectively a suburb of Amsterdam. She grew up in an Orthodox Jewish family in a Warsaw neighborhood that would go on to become the heart of the city's Jewish ghetto, in effect, a public prison established by the German occupier. She was the only member of her family to survive the war, not by hiding under a pigsty, but by pretending to be somebody else, taking on different names and life stories at a time when your identity determined whether you lived or died. My Polish friend and I drive on in silence, and I feign a sudden interest in the dozens, if not hundreds, of billboards we pass along the way. Often they separate the road and a dry ditch from flat grassland with feeble rows of recently planted fir trees. There's a monotony to the world between Chijevo and Warsaw. My friend ventures a question. Do we still need to go to Wrocław to interview Czesław Cholewicki? Cholewicki is the son of the farmer who hid the Jews under his pigsty in Godlewo Wielkie. After the war, as a boy of 15, he moved west to a place that had once been in Germany but became Polish when the borders between the two countries were redrawn. Curiosity triumphs over common sense. Days later, we clock up a few more hours in the car and find ourselves side by side on a couch in the living room of a stone farmhouse near Wrocław. Cholewicki, a man of 88, tells us the tale as he remembers it, how he and his father dug a pit under the pigsty, covering it with two trees and a layer of mud and branches to make a new floor, how a kennel tacked onto the side provided a little fresh air, and how the Jews were allowed out for a short while at night to stretch their legs. His father had trained his dog not to react when it saw them, and luckily the farm was in a remote spot at the edge of the forest, so dogs on neighboring farms didn't bark at every sound or move they made. Cholewicki's account of the Jews' fate is short and to the point. A few days after the two had gone in search of their belongings, his father found their bodies in the forest, murdered, and probably not by the Germans. At the time, Germans were thin on the ground in those parts. Besides, the Jews had not been shot. The Germans were known for gunning people down, not going at them with clubs or pitchforks. The three Jews who remained in hiding stayed put until 2 days after liberation in the spring of 1944. Then they walked back to their looted homes in Chijevo, which, unlike the larger houses on the main square, had not been occupied by Catholic Poles. News of their return spread like wildfire. A group of armed Poles paid them a visit, looking for money, gold, anything of value. People thought any Jew who had survived the whole ordeal must be very rich, said Cholewicki. But those people had nothing. The armed Poles killed the father, mother, and daughter, who had lived for 3 years in the pit beneath the pigs. Then they set out for the farm in Godlewowielkie. The Cholowitzki's dog announced their arrival. Young Czesław ran out the back door and took cover in the bushes. From his hiding place, he heard the Poles screaming at his father. "Where is the Jew's gold? Where have you hidden it?" The men found nothing. "They beat my father so badly he could no longer stand." Within days, he died of his injuries. My Polish friend is right. This is a detour, one of many. Even so, I believe it to be worthwhile, not only because its dispiriting brutality is typical of the detours anyone traveling back in time east of Berlin might make, but also because talking to Czesław Cholowitzki made me realize for the first time that I had been chasing an illusion. I had spent too long trying to unsee all kinds of things. The blocky farmhouses, the billboards, the restaurants built to look like castles, the hundreds of roundabouts named after Pope John Paul II, the mint green favored by the residents of rural Poland when painting their plastered houses. By blotting them out, I had hoped to return to a time before 1946 to describe more vividly the world in which my protagonist lived. But after yet another tale of woe, I understood that I had been searching, obsessively perhaps, for a place that had probably never existed. A fairy tale world of colorful settlements set among green hills and leafy landscapes, where birds sang, streams burbled, and wheat swayed in the fields, where life was not only pure and simple, but alive with a rich sense of community. Cholowitzki's story was a final shove in the right direction. Despite the things I wanted to believe in, it had gradually begun to dawn on me that even without the blocks, billboards, and rain-swept roundabouts, my idealized world was not about to materialize. I understood that 80 years ago, this place was every bit as flat, wet, grim, and cold. That its people, like people everywhere, were capable of terrifying ruthlessness, and that poverty was ugly and appalling. There was a good reason why, before the war, the little town of Czyżewo had been home to people smugglers, two men who, for a substantial sum, could arrange emigration to America, Canada, or Argentina, or, at a pinch, to Germany or Czechoslovakia. Czyżewo's people smugglers lived alongside three egg sellers, an assortment of roofers, masons, peddlers, butchers, and bakers, a watchmaker, two carpenters, a hat maker, a blacksmith, and dozens of Luftmenschen, literally air people, or what we would call dreamers, residents who had to rely on charity. A report from 1939 reveals that organized assistance was the only source of income for 1 in 5 Polish Jews. Journalist Raphael F. Scharf survived the war. In 1939, he was living and working in London as a correspondent for a Polish newspaper. He devoted his later years almost entirely to spreading the word about the Jewish world in which he'd grown up. In countless lectures, he stressed the importance of steering a clear course between nostalgia and reality. "Yes," he wrote, "over 3 million Jews had lived in pre-war Poland and had formed the most vital, life-enhancing branch of Jewish life in the diaspora. They were a spring from which there flowed a contribution to the literary, musical, and scientific legacy of mankind, in disciplines as varied as Talmud studies and modern science." Yet, at the same time, he argued, the crime committed by the Germans was so immense that it is impossible to increase the scale of its inhumanity by idealizing the past. Idealization can only stand in the way of the historical reality. This insight informed my interviews with the protagonist of this book, Mala Rivka Kizel, whose survival story became my guide through the history of Central Europe in the 20th century. Today she lives as Marilka Schlafer, just outside the Dutch capital. She was born in Warsaw, the sixth in a family of eight children, in February 1926. In the chapters that follow, she is Mala. To me, she is Mrs. Schlafer. I visited her on several occasions at her charming yellow brick home, tucked away in a small neighborhood of terraced houses between the Bosbahn rowing lake and the river Amstel. In her light and airy living room with its round table, she welcomed me with coffee and biscuits. Her walls were hung with framed photographs, recent snapshots of her children and grandchildren, and of herself with friends from the local bridge club. One featured a bright-eyed Mrs. Schlafer holding a silver trophy as beaming club members bunched in around her. Mala is the daughter of Esther Doba Saper and Sender Yitzchok Kizel. The colors and brushstrokes in which she paints her childhood are a long way from Marc Chagall's dreamlike visions of Jewish shtetl residents hovering above colorful wooden houses in the company of mythical, sometimes smiling creatures, the occasional fiddle tucked under one arm. Mala loved her parents. She grieved for them, and grieves to this day, almost 80 years after their lives were taken. Yet she has no qualms about telling me that, because she was a girl, her parents paid her little attention. "You were better off as a boy," she says. The children were never allowed too close to their mother, who suffered from an infectious illness, probably tuberculosis. And, health permitting, mother was busy working in the toy shop she ran. "I didn't see much of her," Mala says. "I only remember one kiss on my leg when she was tying my shoelace." Her father devoted his life to studying the Torah and teaching young Talmud scholars, boys only, of course. "My father believed you shouldn't so much as look at a girl, not even your sister. He impressed this on my brothers, who of course were expected to live by the tenets of their faith." The birth of a boy was cause for elaborate celebration, complete with presents and sweets. Girls came into the world in silence. "Father never showed me any real affection, not so much as a pat on the head." Mala is a short woman, neither slim nor plump. Perhaps robust is the best description. White waves of well-kept hair frame her sharp features and keen eyes. Recalling events that expose the deepest abysses of human nature, she speaks with remarkable lightness, a tone I have never really encountered in writings or discussions about the Holocaust. She smiles frequently, and rarely from a sense of awkwardness, yet she trivializes nothing. Her story traverses the abyss. Today's editorials on what we now call identity politics pale by comparison, or at least take on a different hue. Even so, the comparison is worth making. Mala's story is driven by humanity's obsession with nation, state, race, and identity. Before I met Mala, I had already heard an abridged version of her story, told to me by her grandson, Amir Svap, a friend I had lost touch with until the day I turned up at a venue in Warsaw to find him sitting at the piano. A pianist by profession, he was the accompanist to a one-woman show designed to delight Dutch expats with songs that poked fun at the bourgeoisie back home. Amir is a man with unruly curls and fine features, regularly lit up by a roguish smile, suggesting a lightness of heart not easy to rhyme with his contemplative nature. After the show, he told me he had been to Warsaw before. His great-grandmother lay buried in the Jewish cemetery, and he had once gone looking for her grave. We agreed to pay her a visit the next day. Warsaw's vast Jewish cemetery is one of the few physical remnants of the city's Jewish community. We found the headstone we were looking for, and Amir, who had lived in Israel for a time, read the Hebrew inscription. His great-grandmother had died in 1934, when her daughter, Amir's grandmother Mala, was just a girl. Sitting in the sunshine that day, Amir told me how that girl had survived the war. It is a story that has stayed with me ever since. In the months and years that followed, I was seldom able to give a clear account of Mala's life. I would lose myself in the details that seemed to give so much value to a story as improbable as it is true. Those details show survival to be an intense version of growing up, one that draws on all the chameleon-like qualities that resilient teenagers develop along the way, and that can become a matter of life or death when you are compelled to live outside your own group. Mala grew up in a world dominated by people who, however stark their differences, shared a belief in the evil of entire communities, in traits prescribed by ethnicity that could be ranked according to a hierarchy of origin, nationality, and race. After my day with Amir in Warsaw, I visited Mala at home a number of times, and she told me her life story. By then, she had committed this story to paper in a memoir entitled How I Survived the War. I transcribed our recorded conversations, and then, with the transcripts and her memoir to hand, I set out on a journey through time, tracking down the cities, towns, and villages, the people and the buildings that figure in her story, looking for documents, books, and eyewitness accounts to provide more context. This journey raised new questions at every turn, and I put these to Mala on subsequent visits. Email proved useful, too. Mala is a computer-savvy woman in her 90s who answers promptly. More often than not, her answers turned out to be repetitions, echoes of memories she had already shared. Eventually, it dawned on me that her mind was not a reservoir of missing details I could simply tap into. In time, I learned not to bother her as much. I would have to make do with what she had already told me and written down, bolstered by what I could discover through archives, books, and conversations. Poland had another lesson in store. People can simply vanish from the course of history. This happens elsewhere, too, but in Poland, Belarus, and Ukraine especially, entire families, villages, and communities have been carried off on the current of time. When writing his History of Central and Eastern Europe around the time of the Second World War, historian Timothy Snyder chose to call it Bloodlands, a place where soldiers and civilians died in their millions, either murdered or wiped out by hunger, disease, and exhaustion. 1/6 of Polish citizens alive and well in 1939 did not survive the violence of the 8 years that followed. As a percentage, it is the greatest loss of life in any country as a result of the Second World War. Hundreds of thousands, if not millions more, fled the country or were deported. Ethnic consolidation took place on a scale never before witnessed. The ruins and mass graves in the region between Berlin, Minsk, and Kiev formed a blank slate on which totalitarian leaders sought to construct a new, unsullied vision of the future. It was against this background that I set out to piece together a world that once was. Mala's school is a case in point. The finest in Poland, she called it. She even remembered the name of the street where it was located. A simple enough fact to check, you might think. Yet, even armed with this information, it took weeks and consultations with several experts to track it down. or more accurately, until I first laid eyes on proof that the school existed. 75 years on, not a single stone remained of the building itself. Another example, in an area that is now part of Ukraine, but belonged to Poland until 1939, I went looking for a church where Mala had asked the parish priest for a baptismal certificate. "You don't want to be baptized," he told her. "You want to stay alive." And he gave Mala the certificate of a Polish country girl whose name she remembers to this day. This turned out to be no help. The region's church records had been destroyed in the ensuing violence and political upheaval. Letters to the Archdiocese of Lviv, a visit to an abbey near the church, an appointment with the ecclesiastical archives in Warsaw, nothing brought me closer to the priest who had helped Mala. Chastened, but not discouraged, I kept plugging away, probably spurred on by that old maxim from my training as a journalist, "A single source is as good as none." I continued my travels, hungry for present-day confirmation of this story from a distant past. Thankfully, there were other sources closer to home, not least the Jewish Historical Institute in Warsaw. Before long, this became the epicenter of my exploration of Mala's past. It is an institute with a remarkable history, founded on the discovery of 2 milk cans and a few tin boxes buried beneath the rubble of what had once been Warsaw's Jewish ghetto. In the spring of 1943, historian Emanuel Ringelblum hid this unlikely archive under the cellars of several houses. At that point, Ringelblum knew the total destruction of the ghetto was imminent, having been told that its last surviving inhabitants planned to launch a desperate attack with whatever weapons they could lay their hands on, the Warsaw Ghetto Uprising. The milk cans and boxes contained descriptions, documents, and statistics that Ringelblum and his staff had written, collected, and compiled since the earliest days of the ghetto. Their aim was to record as much information as possible about the last gasp of the Jewish community in Poland, and Warsaw in particular. Ringelblum's team consisted of between 50 and 60 historians, writers, journalists, and a handful of untrained volunteers. They collected German propaganda posters, children's drawings, ration coupons, writs, concert announcements, diary excerpts, and even sweet wrappers and tram tickets. They got medical professionals to draw up reports on the effects of hunger in the ghettos. They wrote their own accounts of the community's decline in all its facets. And they even managed to obtain information about the workings of the extermination camps in Treblinka and Chelmno. All so that future historians would not have to rely solely on the records of perpetrators, collaborators, and those who stood by and did nothing. This enormously labor-intensive undertaking, and the diversity of the material, was driven by Ringelblum's view of history. As a historian with a background in social work and journalism, he was keenly aware of how every chronicler colors and reshapes events by describing them. "To ensure objectivity, to achieve as accurate and comprehensive a picture as possible of the war events in Jewish life," he wrote, "we tried to have the same incident described by as many people as possible. By comparing various accounts, the historian is able to arrive at the historical truth, the actual course of the event." 3 of Ringelblum's team survived the war, one of whom helped search for the makeshift archive beneath the rubble of what had been the ghetto. The first milk cans were unearthed in September 1946, followed a few years later by a second cache of boxes. A third milk can remains lost to this day. Through the years, the Institute, which went on to bear Ringelblum's name, has added to the 35,000 pages from the recovered cans and boxes, bringing together yet more pre-war documents, that survived the devastation. Marriage certificates, birth certificates, Yiddish newspapers, the paperwork of aid organizations. The Ringelblum Institute also began to collect a growing number of memoirs written by survivors and established links with dozens of databases digitized by organizations worldwide, granting access to the spoken and written testimonies of thousands of survivors. The Institute helped me dig a little deeper when the questions I put to Mala met with a candid, "I don't know," or "I can't remember." This was a regular occurrence. As far as I could tell, Mala was seldom tempted to interweave stories she had heard or read years later with what she knew from her own experience. In fact, she only really did so when I kept on at her, an approach that never gleaned worthwhile information. She had already told me what she remembered. If I wanted more, I would have to look for it myself. If I wanted to put her life in a historical context, that was fine with her. Go right ahead. But I wasn't to keep badgering her. I've told you what I know. And so, increasingly, I began to make my own way through Mala's world in the company of people who had never known her or whose paths never crossed hers. I immersed myself in the circumstances that sent Mala on an odyssey that took her from Warsaw and western Ukraine to the cities of Bremen and Magdeburg, on to Łódź and Wałbrzych, and then to the Israeli city of Lod. Passing through these places, I learned what life had been like when Mala was there and found leads I was able to follow up at the Ringelblum Institute on returning to Warsaw. Driving along the river Brok towards the Bug, I find myself trying to justify my detour to Godlewo Wielkie and my search for the vanished pigsty in the farmer's garden. I present my Polish friend with fascinating examples from other tributaries I have navigated on my expedition into Mala's world, as if to convince her that the farm we have just left is not so far removed from the great current of European history that swept my protagonist along. I tell her the book I am writing not only contains Mala's own story of survival, but also observations from my own investigations, insights into my search for the fragments of Mala's story, and descriptions of the shores where I hope to find them. Before it had dawned on me that turning up on Mala's doorstep with frequent progress reports wasn't such a good idea, I was surprised that she seemed to have no books, not even picture books, about pre-war Jewish life in Warsaw. She appeared to own no reminders of the time she grew up in, though her memories of that time were remarkably vivid. With this in mind, I decided to give her a present. A book of photos from the 1930s. Such picture books are incredibly popular in Warsaw. The bookshops are full of them. The photos showed the district where Mala was born and raised. Streets that even before the war were mostly home to Polish Jews. Bearded men in black overcoats peered out at us from under wide brims or fur hats. A closer look revealed their peyot, or sidelocks, curling down over their beards. Mala and I looked for photographs of Novolipki Street, where her aunt Surele lived, and where, only two houses away, Ringelblum would later hide two milk cans crammed with archive material. We looked for pictures of Miwa Street, where Mala herself had grown up. We looked for Jika, the street where her father was born, and where, as a girl during wartime, she found a gap that allowed her to sneak in and out of the ghetto. It took me a while to notice that my own enthusiasm for the book far outshone hers. Searching for photos of a world that no longer exists is a task for historians or people of a nostalgic bent. None of this meant much to Mala, who was only playing along for my sake. She cherished none of the illusions about an idyllic world in a distant past that I had carried with me on my first forays into Eastern Europe. Twice she looked me in the eye and asked, What are you hoping to find in that world that no longer exists? What was I doing at that institute in Warsaw? What did it matter if there was no way to find out exactly where and how her brothers and sisters had been murdered? In the end, that was all she really wanted to know. Facts that are nowhere to be found. Staff at the institute tell me Mala is not alone in her desire to know the exact details. What happened to my family? What did they go through in their final minutes? Those are the questions survivors most often ask. It probably has to do with the precision and administrative zeal attributed to the Germans, Noam Silberberg of the Institute explains. Both are hopelessly overrated. The Nazis murdered most of their victims in Poland and further east without leaving a paper trail. Fortunately, he shares my view that there are other reasons for trying to bring a lost world back to life with more than just memories. He works at the Ringelblum Institute, after all. Yet the question remains, how? Let's start in Chijevo. This shtetl on the banks of the River Brok was home to Mala's mother, Esther, when at the beginning of the 20th century she was married off to Sender Yitzchok Kizel. This man, Sender, or Sander, was an imposing figure with a big red beard, and his height earned him the nickname Heucher, Tall Sender. After living in Chijevo for a while, the couple left for Warsaw. He and Esther may have traveled by donkey or perhaps by train. Chijevo had joined the railway network a few decades before. One thing is certain, they did not travel by boat. Although the River Brok linked the shtetl with Warsaw and Gdansk via the Bug and the Vistula, its waters were too treacherous to navigate, and remain so to this day. Instead of footnotes. The words that introduce this prologue, collect everything and sort it out after the war, were spoken by Emanuel Ringelblum in 1941 and lived on in the memory of Herr Wasser, one of only three members of Oneg Shabbat to survive the war. Oneg Shabbat means something like joy of Shabbat, a traditional reference to how devout Jews spend their holy day of rest. It was also the cryptic name given to the clandestine organization led by Ringelblum. After burying the archive material that Oneg Shabbat had gathered, Ringelblum himself went into hiding with his wife and son, sharing the cellar of a greenhouse with a few other families in the garden of a Polish Catholic who lived near the Warsaw Ghetto. This proved riskier than a pit beneath a pigsty. They were betrayed on 7 March 1944, probably by gardeners or a slighted ex-lover of the house's owner. Ringelblum and his family were executed by the Germans, along with two non-Jewish Poles who had helped them go into hiding. The quotes from Raphael F. Scharf date from long after the war, as does his statement, "In mourning the past, it would be wrong to idealize it." This comes from a lecture he gave in Krakow on 14 July 1991 as part of a summer program called Tracing the Jewish Heritage in Poland, organized by Poland's Research Center of Jewish History and Culture. It was later published as What Shall We Tell Miriam in the essay collection Poland, What Have I to Do with Thee, 1996. Scharf's aim was to be as true to life as possible in bearing witness to the world of his youth. In this lecture, he drew upon what he called the only authentic descriptive record of that world, the Yiddish and Hebrew literature of the 1930s. That literature, he said, was compassionate, but also mercilessly critical. The authors portray the sordid conditions, the poverty, the powerlessness, the oppression, the obscurantism, and lash out against it. Poverty was dire and widespread. Historian Bernard Wasserstein, produced a study that echoes the anti-idealization advocated by Scharf. The central theme of his impressive book, On the Eve, The Jews of Europe Before the Second World War, 2012, is that the Jewish world before the Holocaust was in the throes of a major crisis. This, he argues, was not only due to external threats, such as growing antisemitism and exclusive nationalism, but also to the internal pressures of secularization, assimilation, demographic disaster, and growing poverty. On the Eve also includes a wonderful description of Luftmenschen, the destitute members of Poland's Jewish community. Every word attributed to Mala in this prologue, and the 19 chapters that follow, comes either from her memoirs or in the conversations we had at her home in Amstelveen. Work on this book began in 2015 and was completed in mid-2019. Mrs. Marilka Schlafer died in late November 2020 at the age of 94. As she lived to see the book's publication in the Netherlands, I have taken the liberty of rendering her words and recollections in the present tense. 1. The Brok. A mouse being hunted by a cat doesn't pause to reflect upon whether the cat is charcoal-colored or black. Michał Głowiński, a writer who survived the Warsaw Ghetto. Although the river Brok was unnavigable, the people of Czyżewo found a way to float tree trunks to the mills a few kilometers downstream, where the wood was sawn into planks. Logging was the first economic activity in Czyżewo that called for a degree of organization. Later, the production of tzitzis began to take off. White garments worn by Orthodox Jewish men under their black clothes, with dangling, knotted cords to remind the wearer of his religious duties. The name tzitzis, used by Orthodox Jews in Eastern Europe, refers to the dangling cords. The production of these garments was the first real money-making activity in Czyżewo. In demand throughout the Russian Empire, they were later exported to America and Canada, too. Eventually, over a quarter of the world's Orthodox Jews wore tzitzis made in Czyżewo. Around 1887, when Mala's mother, Esther Doba Saper, was born, 30 families were able to earn a living from tzitzis, which could only be made by men. Until then, life in Czyżewo had been tough, even compared to other shtetlach in the region. The shtetl had no other distinction except its poverty. This quote comes from Czyżewo's Yiskor book, a collection of commemorative writing. Many vanished Jewish villages and towns that were once predominantly Jewish have one. The book of Czyżewo was published in Tel Aviv 15 years after the Second World War, and is full of memories written by residents who survived the war. The poverty they describe is also reflected in the statistics from the early 20th century. The provincial archives, now housed in the city of Białystok, give the shtetl's population at the time as 1,495. Shtetl is simply the Yiddish word for a settlement with a market, where many but not necessarily most of the population is Jewish. This was true of all but 34 of Czyżewo's residents. For many years, Czyżewo's population did not expand, though families were large and children numerous. Its residents left for cities such as Łódź and Warsaw, also part of the Russian Empire at the time, or made their way to the port of Danzig and sailed for foreign shores. Infant mortality was high. The average age, low. Almost every severe infection was likely to end in death. The water from the village pump was so filthy that it only served to extinguish the countless fires that broke out in this town of wooden houses, where, after dark, candles and oil lamps were the only source of light. Czyżewo was an Orthodox shtetl. With only a few exceptions, everyone lived by the rules of the faith. However, this small community was also home to various schools of Orthodoxy. At the end of the 19th century, a bitter feud broke out between the Hasidim and their opponents, the Misnagdim. The Hasidim came out on top, leaving the Misnagdim of Chijevo no choice but to resentfully eat meat that they believed had not been slaughtered correctly. Mala's family was Hasidic. Her grandfather inspected the religious schools in the district. A dispute also erupted within Chijevo's Hasidic community between a group that followed the teachings of a spiritual leader from Ger, or Góra Kalwaria, as it is known in Polish, and a group that followed a rabbi from the Alexander dynasty. The Ger camp were easy to recognize. They tucked their trouser legs into their socks. The clash led each group to establish its own separate place of worship. Everyone spoke Yiddish to one another and could get by in Polish when dealing with the police, postal workers, firemen, and other officials, and with the town's Catholic residents, whose number grew to around 200 in the 1930s. The Jews of Chijevo also spoke Polish with the local farmers, who visited the town once a week to sell their produce on the main square. Mala's parents married in 1905, first in Warsaw, then in Chijevo. Mala believes her mother's marriage was arranged when she was 13, yet the official marriage certificate held by the government archives in Białystok gives the bride's age as 18, 2 years older than the legal age to be married. The bridegroom, Sender Yitzchok Kizel, was 24. At the archive, I learned that separate agreements were sometimes made through a matchmaker. And in Esther's case, this might have been when she turned 13. Mala also tells me that her parents saw each other for the first time at their wedding, the kind of detail a marriage certificate can never reveal. An unlikely one, too, given that man and wife in a traditional Jewish match normally have the chance to meet in a chaperoned setting at least once. However, the certificate does state which family offered kest, the obligation to maintain the newlyweds for a period of time. It was usually the matchmaker who brokered such an agreement, along with arrangements as to who was to contribute what to the new household. Shabbat candle holders, menorahs, silver spoons, jewelry, and so on. In the case of Mala's parents, the kest lay with the family of the bride, which explains why the couple lived in Chijevo for quite a while before leaving for Warsaw. They left shortly before the First World War. In the nick of time, you might say, as there was trouble ahead for the shtetl. After the First World War, Chijevo became part of Poland, a country resurrected on the drawing board at Versailles after 123 years of non-existence. The Russian armies set fire to countless homes as they retreated, and a soap factory and four windmills were among the other buildings torched along the way. Then came the forces led by Józef Haller, an anti-Semitic Polish nationalist. His Blue Army of volunteers celebrated victory over the fledgling Soviet Union, 1920 to 1921, by humiliating and even torturing the Jewish population, whom they saw as Bolshevik collaborators. They beat and kicked the men, shaved off their beards, and forced them to perform pointless tasks, such as leading cattle from one village to the next. Several residents of Chijevo died at the hands of these Hallerists. The same geopolitical shift led to the collapse of the local industry, robbing Chijevo of access to the vast Russian hinterland that had been a crucial market for tzitzis. The shtetl's population did not return to pre-war level until the 1930s. Driven out by the increasing anti-Semitism in the surrounding villages, Jews came to Chijevo. There they found safety in numbers, a sense of circling the wagons, to use the old American pioneering expression. And sticking with the metaphor, it wasn't long before those keeping lookout saw trouble on the horizon. For the people of Czyżewo in 1939, this meant the advance of the Red Army. In much of the world, this is a largely forgotten aspect of the Second World War. Not in Poland. The German Wehrmacht's offensive, launched on 1 September 1939, was followed by a Soviet attack from the east 16 days later, a coordinated strike by the two powers. In secret supplementary protocols to the non-aggression treaty that had gone down in history as the Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact, Stalin and Hitler had agreed to carve up Eastern Europe between them. One half of Poland, including Warsaw, was to become part of Germany. The Eastern Polish lands, which at that time also comprised part of present-day Lithuania, Belarus, and Ukraine, would fall to the Soviet Union. Czyżewo lay in the Soviet section. The Germans and the Soviets celebrated their victory in style with a joint military parade in Brest-Litovsk on the newly drawn border between their two countries. In the months that followed, the Red Army rounded up over 300,000 inhabitants of the newly occupied region and deported them to places deep within the Soviet Union. Though they targeted intellectuals and landowners, the selection process could be fairly random. In some cities, towns, and villages, Soviet soldiers simply rounded up anyone who was wearing glasses and branded them an intellectual. Another approach was to inspect people's hands. Those with soft skin and well-trimmed fingernails faced immediate deportation. They had clearly never done a hard day's manual labor in their lives. The handful of communists in the region were tasked with helping to decide who should stay and who should be deported. So, too, in Czyżewo, where communists could be counted on the fingers of one hand. Communists were atheists, after all, so why would they make their home in a Jewish Orthodox settlement? One such man, big, square-jawed, and sporting a crew cut, had been a teacher at the shtetl's only public school. His name was Klar, and he was known as an atheist rather than a communist, though his love for the dictatorship of the proletariat was quick to surface in the first days of Soviet occupation. He betrayed people he had treated as friends only a short time before, people whose children he had taught. Years later, in Czyżewo's Book of Remembrance, some survivors still felt the need to vent their disgust in no uncertain terms. How could he have done such a thing? Almost 2 years after the Soviets arrived, the Germans came to Czyżewo. Hitler had unleashed Operation Barbarossa in an effort to bring the Soviet Union to its knees in a single summer. The Wehrmacht stormed through the region, but not without receiving a warm welcome from its Catholic Poles. They erected a makeshift triumphal arch for the Germans on the Western Access Road to Czyżewo. This features in a report written by a Polish resistance fighter who traveled through the area around Białystok at the time. He was an officer in the Armia Krajowa, or Home Army, Poland's largest resistance force. It had a traditional command structure, and its leaders took orders from the government in exile. Reporting to his superiors, the officer confirmed what the government already feared. The region's Poles saw the Germans as liberators. The officer, who had just come from Lithuania, wrote that the situation further east was even worse. The people of Czyżewo and environs were soon cured of any initial enthusiasm. The Germans, like the Soviets, were aiming to wipe the Polish nation from the face of the earth. The locals were pressed into the service of the German war machine, either by supplying produce from their own land or by working in the industries of the Third Reich further west. But in those early days, the departure of the communists brought a sense of relief. Among the region's anti-Semitic Poles, expectations also ran high as regards settling scores with the Jews. Many saw Jews as collaborators, because in 1939, a small minority, men like Klar, the teacher, had welcomed the Red Army with open arms. During the late 1930s, the well-established myth that a Jew was a communist and vice versa had already been ramped up in the propaganda spread by Poland's National Democrats, NDEX for short. The German occupation amplified this message. The resistance officer stated in his report that the enmity of Poles toward the Jews had become so great that the local population does not imagine how normal relations could be re-established. In Chijevo, the officer no longer encountered a single Jew. Some had fled with the Red Army. Others, he learned from the farmers in the region, had disappeared between Zarembe and Chijevo on a road that runs through a landscape of lakes and gorges. A reconstruction years later estimates that over 2,000 of Chijevo's residents were killed there, not far from the village of Szulboże Wielkie, shortly after the arrival of German forces. A group of Poles had taken the presence of German soldiers as the start sign for a pogrom that, under German leadership, descended into a massacre. Historians tell me that the exact details of the massacre are difficult to unpick. Reinhard Heydrich, head of the German Reich's main security office, had decreed that same month that the aim was to provoke local pogroms without leaving traces. After the fact, local militias or farmers were not to be able to claim they had been following orders. 2 days after the Germans arrived, Cholewicki, the farmer from neighboring Godlewo Wielkie, whose son I visited, walked past a place where he had heard hours of shooting. He saw the ground move and put this down to the gases released when bodies start to decompose. A hellish sight, he would later tell his son. At least two members of Mala's family fell victim to this first wave of killings, including Freda Saper, her mother's twin sister. Has anything of pre-war Chijevo survived to this day? Not really. The occasional wooden house with a pointed roof harks back to the old days, though most have been repainted in bright colors never seen before 1941. Some even have bright blue roof tiles, which gives them a Lego-like appearance. Running water only reached the town in the 1950s, followed soon after by electricity. The contours of the small market square can still be traced, although nowadays traffic thunders across it, bound for Białystok to the east or Warsaw to the west. The church still stands. Its broad, creamy yellow facade seems somehow out of proportion, dwarfing the other buildings on the former square. It is also the only building not to feature advertising or a garish frontage. Pre-printed ad banners even veil the red brick of a synagogue that survived the war, one trumpeting the name of a major meat processing plant, Vipash. The town also boasts a monument. I find it on a corner, opposite a blue-painted wooden house that serves as a post office. It consists of an upright chunk of granite with a copper-colored plaque honoring the memory of the Poles who died winning back our country's independence. This is a reference to the aforementioned war between the fledgling Polish Republic and the equally young Soviet Union. The Poles who died in that conflict clearly did not come from the shtetl of Chijevo. So how did this monument, erected in 1928, end up in an almost entirely Jewish town where restoring Polish independence was not exactly high on the agenda? A local historian tells me it's not unusual to find such monuments in the shtetlach of the region. They should be seen as markers of the electoral victories by the anti-Semitic index, he explains. Standing by the ballot boxes, wielding clubs and other weapons, index stopped Jews from voting, and once they were elected to the council that ran a Jewish town, they would thumb their noses at the Jewish residents by erecting a nationalist monument. This is Poland, and in Poland we celebrate all things Polish. That kind of thing. In 1940, the Soviets had the monument pulled down, and balking at the idea of having to destroy something so massive, they buried it instead. The Poles unearthed it in 1981 and hoisted it upright once again. Mala's father grew up on Jika Street in Warsaw, just a few blocks south of the house in which Mala grew up. She believes her father's entire family came from the capital. This is probably because her aunts, her father's three sisters, all lived nearby, in what was Warsaw's most Jewish neighborhood at the time. But the archives tell a different story. Sender's mother hailed from Tyszowce, and his father from Krasnobrud. Both towns are not far from Zamość, which lies around 200 kilometers east of Kraków, and for centuries fulfilled a major role in the Jewish world in Eastern Europe. On 8 July 1864, Mala's grandfather and grandmother married in Tyszowce. Both of them were 22, which in those days was relatively old for a bride. Official figures show that over half the Jewish brides at the time were under 21. This altered rapidly in the decades that followed. In just one illustration of an Orthodox Jewish world that may have appeared static, but in reality was seething with change. Looking again at the marriage certificate from 1964, it's not so much the age of Mala's grandparents that is striking, but their surnames. Grandmother, Kizel. Grandfather, Kizel. An archivist explains that this subtle difference in spelling was probably the work of the registrar in attendance. In all likelihood, the couple were directly related. This was not uncommon, nor was the tendency of public officials to fudge the issue by altering the spelling. The archivist sees his theory confirmed in the surnames of the children born to the couple. In official documents, they all bear the name Kizel. The marriage certificate only gives this as their mother's surname, but most likely it was their father's name, too. Unless the parents shared the same surname, you'd expect the children to be called Kizel. It takes a moment for this to sink in. What excites the archivist most of all is the language in which the marriage certificate is written. This must be one of the last marriage certificates in Polish. Having crushed yet another armed uprising, the Russian rulers banned the use of Polish in official documents, a ban imposed in the year that Mala's grandparents were married. And, sure enough, when the Kizel's son, Mala's father, gets married 40 years later, the registrar documents the event in Russian. What else can this old certificate in Polish tell us? It tells us that the father of Mala's grandfather was no longer alive, that his mother earned a living from manual labor on an estate belonging to one of the Glogowskis, a family so wealthy that they owned the town of Tyszowce until 1944. Mother was the daughter of a grain merchant, the certificate states. Merchant may well be too grand a title. Most likely he bought grain from local farmers, had it ground at the nearest mill, and then sold the flour to other villagers from his home. Lastly, the document tells us that no notary was present at the marriage ceremony, owing to a lack of property. Tyshovtse was not a place of any great significance, but it certainly outshone Chijevo. In addition to a Jewish past, it boasted a Polish history stretching back to the Middle Ages. Situated on a trade route, the town was enough of a prize to be repeatedly looted and destroyed. The Tartars laid waste to it in around 1500, the Swedes about a century later, and then came the Cossacks, not once, but twice. Each time, Tyshovtse was rebuilt. In the 18th century, the town became widely known for a special type of boot produced there. Known as Tyshovyaki, their major selling point was that the left and right boot were identical. Jewish life in Tyshovtse began to flourish when the town and the lands that surrounded it came under the ownership of a man called Jan Meir. In need of a middle class of merchants and people to collect taxes from local farmers, Meir encouraged Jews to settle in Tyshovtse by offering them special privileges. Jews were far better suited to these roles than Polish serfs because they could read, though not necessarily in the local language. Even in the darkest of times, Jewish parents invariably taught their children to read. The Jews were the people of the book, and anyone who could not read the sacred texts for themselves was ill-equipped to take part in religious life. To be a practicing Jew, you had to be literate. In the Orthodox Jewish world, it was a vicious religious feud that put Tyshovtse on the map. The trouble began in 1881 when Hasidic Jews accused the local rabbi of charging excessive prices for his kosher meat. The rabbi belonged to the opposing Misnagid movement, and the town's Misnagdim were incensed. Tensions steadily built, erupting into violence 1 year later. All the windows in the house of worship were smashed, and Russian soldiers had to be called in to restore order. The Hasidim then reported the rabbi to the Russian authorities for helping draft dodgers escape across the border to the Habsburg Empire, only a few miles south. The Russians investigated, but found no proof, leaving the Hasidim to resort to other means to rid themselves of the rabbi. By which means remains unclear, but disappear he did, and his position remained vacant for decades. It was during those years that Tall Sender's parents, Mala's paternal grandparents, left Tyshovtse for Warsaw, not a national capital at the time, but a big city in the west of the Russian Empire. Stroll through Tyshovtse today and you will mainly see cheap brickwork from the 1950s and the blocky farmhouses built from the 1960s onwards. Most have a white, rust-rimmed satellite dish clinging to a roof or balcony. The town had to be entirely rebuilt after the First World War, and again after the Second, only this time without the Jewish population. None of Tyshovtse's Jewish residents returned, not even the few who had survived the Holocaust deep in the Soviet Union. In September 1939, Red Army soldiers offered local Jews the chance to travel east with them, shortly after their annexation of the town and before they made way for the Wehrmacht under the terms agreed between Germany and the Soviet Union. About 1,300 Jews chose to stay. The Germans spared only those they considered strong enough to work in a camp on the banks of the Huchva, a river that, like the Brock, flows into the Bug. Until October 1942, the camp's laborers were made to reinforce the banks to make the river navigable. Then they were loaded onto wooden carts and transported 18 miles south to the Belzec extermination camp. Today, Tyshovtse is home to a mere 350 people, less than 5% of the population in 1939. A small park now stands on what used to be the town square. The village elder, the Sotis, confirms that Tishovtse's main visitor attraction is its cemetery. Mala grew up in a family of 8 children. She was child number 6, only 10 months older than her younger brother. Another brother, Meir, was born 2 years later. Their mother died at the age of 47, not long after Mala's 8th birthday. She still remembers the bewilderment she felt. Where had her mother gone? After the funeral, she kept asking the mourners why mother wasn't coming home with them. It moved everyone to tears, but no one thought to sit me down and explain what had happened. Mala's sisters and aunts filled the gap left by her mother. Compared to the dire poverty that was the norm in Warsaw's Jewish quarter, the Kizels were not badly off. They occupied a single floor of a building, the daughters sleeping in one room and the sons in another. There was no shower or hot water. Even the toilet was outdoors, but their father was able to pay 2 housekeepers. A Polish woman came 4 days a week, and a Jewish woman 2 days, Mala recalls. It's a distinction that gives pause for thought. It would be more accurate to distinguish between a Catholic Polish housekeeper and a Polish Jewish housekeeper. But in 1930s Poland, everyone, like Mala, spoke of Jews and Poles. In modern-day Poland, little has changed. Here, you are either a Pole or a Jew, journalist Anna Bikont explains. It's a mindset she actively resists. She sees herself as both Jewish and Polish, a Polish Jew, and has done since discovering that her mother is Jewish, a discovery she did not make until she was in her 30s. Bikont's mother survived the war thanks to the false papers given to her by a non-Jewish Pole. The two fell in love, married, and decided to spare their children the ordeal of living as Jews in Poland. It's a decision Bikont does not accept, and now that she knows about her background, she wants to stand up and be counted as a Polish Jew. In a recent online survey, she discovered what an alien concept this is for the Public Records Office. In order to tick a box to say I am Jewish, I first had to answer no to the question of whether I am Polish. I had to select Jewish from a list of options that included Ukrainian, German, Belarusian, and a few other nationalities. To this day, in Poland, being Jewish is still considered a nationality. Returning to the Kizels, I will also refer to their Polish-Jewish housekeeper and Polish non-Jewish housekeeper as Jewish and Polish, respectively. Not only does it make for easier listening, but the notion of Jewishness as a nationality was also very fitting for the times. Mala explains that her father put more trust in the Polish housekeeper than the Jewish one, because she was better informed about the kashrus, or Jewish dietary laws. She kept a close eye on the children and made sure they did as they were told. Father ran a school at the family home on Miwa Street. From the front window, you could look across to number 18, where the last doomed fighters of the Warsaw Ghetto Uprising fought to the bitter end in April 1943. The street had been pounded to rubble almost 4 years earlier in the 1939 aerial bombardment of Warsaw, a key element of Germany's blitzkrieg. At least 22,000 people died in the attack, over 20 times the death toll in Rotterdam, another European city razed by German bombers, and equaling the death toll of the notorious Allied bombardment of Dresden 6 years later. Before the bombs fell, Miwa Street had been lined with tall houses, most with 5 floors and a large courtyard at the back where children played among the washing that was hung out to dry. At the end of the street lay Muranowski Square with its market. Tall Sender's religious school went by the name of Grodzisker Klois, after a rabbi who came from a Hasidic family with its origins in Grodzisk, a shtetl not far from the capital, and whose teachings Sender followed. Klois is a Yiddish word for a place of study. Among the host of Yiddish newspapers on the market in the 1920s and 1930s, I find two reports about the school. The first reveals that 4 years after his wife's death, Tall Sender found himself in dire financial straits, facing eviction and the forced sale of his household goods. Mala has no recollection of this episode. The second item, from another newspaper and dated only days later, reports that Sender's financial problems have been solved, but gives no indication of what has brought about this change in fortune. Mala does remember that the house was never quiet. Her father's pupils read aloud from dawn to dusk, interrupted only occasionally by a lesson from their teacher. Mala vaguely remembers the presence of supervisors, part of the regime in every traditional Jewish religious school. They made sure pupils did not shirk or smuggle in free-thinking literature, such as novels or other light reading. News was also strictly forbidden. "Newspapers were no good for us Orthodox folk," Mala recalls. "We had to pray and pray and pray. That's what I was taught." But there were books. Noam Silberberg of the Ringelblum Institute has found the name Sender Kizel printed in Hebrew books, theological studies published with his help. If enough people decided to club together to fund a publication, a subscription was opened. When there were enough subscribers, and therefore enough money, the book was published, and a list of donors was printed at the back. An early form of crowdfunding. Thinking back on the house she grew up in, Mala pictures entire walls crammed with books from floor to ceiling. Father used a ladder to reach the books he needed. Unlike Orthodox parents in the shtetlach, those in the capital were unable to build a wall between life as they believed it should be lived and the tumult of the ever-changing world beyond. They did try, however, and these attempts could ignite fierce intergenerational battles between fathers and sons. Meanwhile, there were daughters who converted in order to run off with a dashing military officer, or who abandoned the God-fearing life to pursue a career as a singer, dancer, or actress in the city's burgeoning entertainment industry. Some parents responded by observing the official mourning ritual known as sitting Shiva. By making the huge sacrifice of pronouncing their wayward daughter dead, they hoped the shame would disappear and the natural order would resume. But anyone who lacked a talent for self-delusion could see how futile this was. Change was everywhere. Paradoxically, or perhaps not, the rise of the nationalist index and their violence against Jews went hand in hand with the flourishing of Jewish political parties, cultural clubs, and places of entertainment, to say nothing of a growing number of writers and poets who freely chose to work in one of the three languages available to them, Hebrew, Yiddish, or Polish. There was a particularly dramatic rise in the number of Yiddish publications, often expressing views on what today we would call issues of identity. Who are we? What is our role in society? How should we and others go about fulfilling this role? Articles written during Mala's childhood reveal that Jews in Poland saw three options for themselves: leaving the country, assimilating into the majority Polish culture, or standing their ground while staying true to their Jewishness. Each option came in a variety of forms. Did assimilation mean abandoning your own faith and language, and even converting to Catholicism? As a self-respecting Jew, was it permissible to leave for America or Germany? Or was the Holy Land the only decent option? And did standing your ground imply clinging to every last letter of the Jewish traditions and customs developed through the centuries on Polish soil? For men like Mala's father, the answers to these questions were far from complex. The customs, traditions, and tenets of belief that his father before him had observed did more than shape his life. They were its very purpose. For Tall Sender, this was so self-evident that he failed to notice his children changing before his very eyes, and their urge to live a life that was not dictated by tradition. Mala's older sister, Mira, is a perfect example. Her father would not let her go to high school. It was enough for a daughter to be able to write Yiddish. A woman's duty was to bear children and care for her husband. A good woman would also bring a measure of contentment and happiness to a marriage, but that was a bonus, not a requirement. Daughter Mira saw things differently. She wanted to attend university, and without Tall Sender's knowledge, she put herself through a school that could give her that opportunity. She earned her tuition fees, often working deep into the night at a sewing machine, stitching embroidery on cushions and quilts. Today, the practicalities of this are almost beyond our comprehension. How can you go to school without your father knowing? In Mira's case, her gender was a definite advantage. Tall Sender paid her less heed than he did his sons. As Scharf, our guide to this vanished world, puts it, the aspirations of the parents were focused on the male child, which made it even more of an achievement that Azriel, his eldest son, managed to do the same. Tall Sender hoped that all his sons would become rabbis, Talmud scholars who would one day reach a higher rung on the religious ladder than he had. These hopes were mainly pinned on his firstborn, a clever but sickly boy. Tall Sender talked about how he and Esther had spent a small fortune taking Azriel to one doctor after another, even traveling as far as Vienna. They had also paid a hefty sum to keep him out of military service. But the apple of their eye did not have the calling, and secretly enrolled at a technical school. It was not his father or mother, but Mala who found him out. At home, she discovered the parcel of clothes her brother took with him to change into before he entered the school. Mala was 11 years old at the time, Azriel in his early 20s. She confronted her brother, and he admitted everything. It had all started with a part-time job in a factory, he explained, and made her promise not to tell their father. It was a promise Mala was all too happy to keep. There were enough tensions in the family without father hearing about this. Mala struggles to give examples of the strained atmosphere at home. That said, one fairly trivial incident has stayed with her. Azriel coming home one day with a chocolate cake in the shape of the great synagogue on Tłomackie Square. Azriel thought everyone would be delighted. Such a lovely cake, and delicious into the bargain. But my parents were furious with him. What were you thinking? How can we eat a synagogue? The cake went untouched. Later, Mala remembers another episode, one involving a red-haired teen from Chijevo. The boy's parents had sent him from the shtetl into the care of Tall Sender. The idea was that he could continue his Talmud studies while doing something to improve his posture, which was in a very bad way. This was a common problem among young Hasidim and had to do with their schooling, which began at an early age. As soon as they could talk, they learned holy blessings from their mother. They soon went from mother's care to father's knee, and if father was a scholar, like Sender, he was usually at home poring over his books, rocking back and forth with his father as he grappled with the meaning of the sacred texts, the little lad would pick up the sing-song melody of study. From the age of 3, he would go to cheder, where little boys, not girls, learned the Hebrew alphabet and their first prayers, sitting in the same position as their fathers, hunched over the same texts. There was little opportunity to play outdoors and run around. The child was expected to devote around 10 hours a day to lernen, studying. Scharf observes, "That was how the young Jewish boy in the shtetl sat, from 8 in the morning until 6 in the evening, 5 days a week, and a half day on Friday, in a small, often shabby and musty-smelling room in the home of the teacher, where 15 or 20 children of different ages were crammed in together." Lots of Hasidim were hunched from all the time they spent sitting and learning, Mala remembers, but this boy was in worse shape than most. As a teenager, he looked like a little old man. The boy's parents in Chijevo saw that something had to be done, so they dispatched the young yeshiva student to cousin Esther's family in the big city. Her husband, tall Sender, had a sporting nephew who was a gym teacher. And as Sender was an exceptionally devout man, they had no concerns about entrusting their son to his keeping. In taking the boy on, Sender had his own agenda. He hoped that the deep-seated faith of a pious kid from Chijevo might rub off on the not-so-pious sportsman. Things took a different turn. The boy's faith in God Almighty proved to be no match for the gym teacher's conviction that he did not exist. And unlike Tall Sender's sons, the red-haired boy made no attempt to disguise his inner turmoil. After every gym session, he confronted Sender with a series of unsettling questions, and things deteriorated to the point where Sender felt obliged to alert the family in Chijevo. Mala doesn't know exactly what his telegram said, but she did witness the response from the shtetl. "I can picture it to this day," Mala says. Suddenly, a big man with a long gray beard was standing in the doorway. He looked furious. The boy was sitting at the table. I was doing something else at the time, I can't remember what. The man marched up to his son, belted him one, hauled him to his feet, and dragged him out of the room. Not a word was spoken. The boy's father took him straight back to Chijevo. "Better to be a hunchback than godless." I never saw him again. The story brings back warm memories, Mala explains, because she liked her cousin, the gym teacher. David Rosenblatt was his name. She was especially fond of his mother, Aunt Surele. The affection was mutual. Surele called Mala Mamele, or Little Mother, because on her deathbed, Surele's mother, Mala's paternal grandmother, talked about the birth of a girl with my soul. The next girl to be born was named after her, Mala Rivka Kizel. Aunt Surele was a widow and lived at 51A Novolipki Street, 5 blocks nearer the old city center. Mala often dropped in to see her as a little girl, and Surele used to spoil her. "She would wash my hair, something no one at home ever did." Mala had to keep these visits to herself because her mother had no time for her sister-in-law. Surele was frowned upon for not raising her children devoutly enough, and, worse still, for not being honest about it. At mother's instigation, a family boycott was imposed. The threat of secularization was to be avoided at all costs. One of Mala's elder sisters brought this threat even closer to home than Surele and her sporting son, confronting Mala's parents head-on with the ways of the new world. Sure, not to be confused with Surele, had a lot in common with her little sister. Like Mala, she was fair-haired and spoke Polish with virtually no accent, something she learned at a good Polish school she had attended without her parents' knowledge or in the shadow of their overwhelming indifference. She had found her own way in the world and ran her own kindergarten. Sure ended up falling in love with Henryk Trager, a man from an assimilated background who could not even understand Yiddish. Father intervened and locked Sure away for a month. The idea that his daughter would not marry a Hasid horrified him. A non-Orthodox man was bad enough, but an unbeliever without an ounce of respect for his own culture? While Sure was under lock and key, her customers, mothers with young children, came knocking on tall Sender's door. Where was their kindergarten teacher? Father did not answer. 80 years on, Mala finds it hard to judge whether her father really thought that denying Sure contact with her sweetheart for a month would solve matters, or whether it was a punishment born of panic and powerlessness. She remembers smuggling letters from Henrik to her sister. "He paid me to take them to her," Mala recalls. After 4 weeks, my father let Sure go and told her she could forget her dowry. But there was no doubt who had lost. Sure's will was unbroken. She was also in luck. A cousin of her mother's, who had made his fortune as an industrialist in Berlin, returned to Polish soil in the autumn of 1938, when the Nazis expelled all Jews with a Polish passport from the Third Reich. Some 17,000 in total. Poland was reluctant to receive these deportees, and many found themselves in a camp set up by Jewish organizations in Zbonsin. Conditions there were rough, and the brush manufacturer from Berlin was wealthy enough to make his own arrangements. He moved into the Bristol, one of Warsaw's most exclusive hotels, a cream-colored neoclassical building topped off by a domed pavilion and situated on the elegant Krakowskie Przedmieście, a sweeping avenue that ran from the monarch's 17th-century suburban palaces to the medieval city. As Mala tells it, Mother's affluent cousin always wore a white suit. He was very fond of Sure, and footed the bill for the wedding to her assimilated non-believer of a suitor. He also found them a home, not only advancing them a year or two's rent, but also fitting the place out, right down to the toothbrushes. The cousin's contribution went further still. He even managed to convince tall Sender to grudgingly accept the union between his daughter and Henrik. Sure's husband was also willing to make concessions. As an upstanding member of the religious community, the tall school director wanted his sons and sons-in-law at his side when he walked to the synagogue on Friday. Non-believer Henrik Trager was willing to indulge him. Sender supplied him with a prayer shawl to cover his head and shoulders, and Trager wore it. In the end, Alter was the only son to live up to his father's ideal. He was only 4 years older than Mala and became a rabbi at the age of 19, shortly before most of the ghetto's inhabitants were sent to Treblinka. Mala describes him as big, handsome, and blonde. He was very strict in his ways. "He would never hand me a bunch of keys. He always put them down on the table so he would not touch my hand, his little sister's hand." 80 years on, Mala still sounds incredulous. To truly grasp the conflicts that rocked the Jewish world in the 1930s, it may be worth considering that for Hasidim like Tal Sender and Alter, the world of marriage, boyfriends, schooling, and trips to the cinema was in no way separate from their own lives, dominated by the study of the Torah. This was not about book learning versus everyday life, although, of course, that is how it appeared, even to Mala. Matters relating to halacha, that is to say, all aspects of how to live one's life, are part of the Talmud, which incorporates the pronouncements of many sages from the early rabbinic period. There is a set procedure. After studying a matter from many different perspectives, scholars arrived at a definitive decision, not least on issues of fidelity and love. Halacha comes from the Hebrew for to go or to walk. This means that vast sections of Jewish religious texts are devoted to human relations, to the tensions that arise between spouses, to familial habits, and matters of upbringing. Tall Sender may have seemed unworldly in the eyes of a young, urban generation, but that was certainly not how he viewed himself. He knew about human relations precisely because he spent all day, every day, poring over the sacred texts. At the same time, the definitive nature of the decisions taken by the scholars prevented him from adopting a certain freedom of spirit along the lines of new morals for a new age. Another element at play is that the Torah is not structured chronologically. The answers to the questions addressed in the scripture come from all ages, as do the comments on those answers. Present and past intermingle, or rather, they become one. Scharf describes how this worked in practice. The student in the yeshiva takes part in a debate between Hillel and Shammai, two great teachers from around the beginning of the Common Era. Then he interrogates the viewpoint of a teacher from the 17th century to finally arrive at his own independent conclusion, which in turn is then ridiculed or greeted with approbation by his fellow students. When it came to Mala's schooling, the Talmud obliged Tall Sender to heed the law of the land. In Poland, the law stated that every child, including children from the Yiddish-speaking community, had to attend a government-approved school from the age of 7. But which school? Her sister, Mira, knew that a palace of a school had opened its doors 2 years earlier, within walking distance of their home. It had been founded with money bequeathed by philanthropist Leopold Mejet, a lawyer and leading expert on Polish literature who died in 1912. In keeping with his principles, the school was an idealistic multicultural project, intentionally located in one of the city's poorer neighborhoods. Mejet was a Polish Jew who wanted to bridge the wide gulf between the Yiddish and Polish cultures at a time when both were suffering under Russian repression. Though he did not advocate assimilation and had no desire to shrug off his Jewish background, he was very much a Polish nationalist. This combination was not unusual in the 19th century, when Polish nationalists were mainly focused on resisting foreign oppression, as opposed to targeting alien elements among their own people. Nationalists could be anarchist, socialist, Jewish, Catholic, or any number of things. For Mejet, nationalism mainly meant elevating ordinary people, whether they were Catholic, Jewish, German, Lemko, Belarusian, or from any other minority, to become fully-fledged citizens of a Polish republic that had yet to take shape. His writing reveals a preoccupation with raising the standard of living, combating illiteracy, and promoting Polish literature. The tuition fees at Mejet's were...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.